morning.
Good morning.
It's better. I'd like to have an energetic class. Okay, so my name is Sumita and I work for Oxford University Press. I am here to give you a presentation on our journal's platform and also to give you an insight on how you can get your work published with Oxford University Press. The session will primarily be split into two parts, and the first part will last about 55 to 60 minutes, after which I'll give you a 15-minute break. You can go grab a cup of tea, coffee, room break, whatever, and be back in 15 minutes, and the remaining will last for another 40 minutes. The second part of the session isn't very tedious, but the first half is a lot of download. I will be giving you a lot of heavy information, and I suggest you pay attention because if you follow the first part, you'll be able to link it to the second part. Does it sound okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, before I start, I'd just like to ask you a question. What are your primary subjects of interest? What subject? Technology. You, ma'am?
Information technology.
Anyone, anything else apart from information technology? Entrepreneurship. Human behavior, psychology, good. Anything else? Finance, okay. How many of you are familiar with journals? How many of you have ever looked at journals? Have ever done their research on journals? You have. So which journals do you use? Which platform do you use when you look at journals? Amethyst. Emerald. So you're using Emerald, which is a publishing house. Okay. Anything else? Scopus. Okay. This is very strong in technology. Okay. So I'm from Oxford University Press, and much as I hate to say it, we're very strong in humanities, we're very strong in medicine, social sciences, law, but we're not all that great with engineering. You may not get a lot of material in engineering or technology. Nevertheless, I'm sure you'll find something useful. So I'm just giving you a heads up before you get disheartened and say, I went and I didn't find it. So I'm just telling you, we're very strong in these five subject areas, but we're a little behind in technology and engineering. Okay, so here we are. So what are we going to cover today? We're going to do the introduction to our company. We will do the differences between a thesis and an article. You just don't have to sit with your friends. You can sit in the front row. I'm a vegetarian. I don't eat too much meat. So you don't need to be scared. I won't eat you up. I promise. So we will do differences between a thesis and an article. We will do how you can turn your thesis into an article. I give you snippets. I give you a little information on how you can write a manuscript. What are the different kinds of journal manuscripts that are accepted? Yes, ma'am, you can come and sit in front. Ideally, you can see it, I'm sure. Do you have cons? Okay. And then we will talk about how you can select which journal you can write for, how you can upload a manuscript on the OUP platform, and the article submission process. We'll do the journal publishing cycle, and not me, Sumita, who represents Oxford University Press, standing with the mic and saying, hey, we are Oxford and we are the best. No. This is data collated by a company called Thomson Reuters. It's in there. They have a division called Clarivate Analytics. And according to their reports, this is where we stand. 70% of journals have an impact factor. 80% rank in the top 50% of at least one category. Six journals are ranked number one in at least one category. And this is, of course, data of 2017. We've had about 100 million downloads. And we are high in quality. Whatever you see published in Oxford University Press journals, you can be sure that they've been rigorously peer-reviewed. We check for authenticity, we check for plagiarism, we check for results before it is finally out to the public. So you can be sure that what you get on the OUP platform is 100% correct. You know, when you have a headache, what do? You all go to Google, right? Google is always your go-to. And if you read any disease, if you read a common cold, it will eventually lead you to cancer. Even if it's a stomach pain, they'll say you've got cancer, stomach cancer. The last option is always stomach cancer. And when you go and tell the doctor says, who asked you to check Google? So while you can start your search with Google, we don't ask you to recommend or cite it. Because if you're citing it, you're probably citing incorrect information. And especially Wikipedia, where anyone can go and change what they want. There's no authenticity of content. And there's no one taking responsibility for what is there. This is according to the Journal Citation Report published by Thomson Reuters. This is where we stand. 25% of our journals rank in the top 10% category. And the remaining rank in the top 25% category. You see how good. I'm not saying this. Thomson Reuters. How do we sell journals? We sell them to individuals. Maybe there's a doctor who's probably doing his research on cardiology, and he subscribes to our European Heart Journal. So we have the European Heart Journal, which he subscribes to. So it's an individual subscription. We have institutions. Your institution could probably subscribe to our journals. So it would be sold to an institution. And we also sell them through consortia, which means we sell them to universities under the UGC category. So you know, most government universities come under that. Now we'll talk about the life. Every person sitting in this room, why are you here? You're here because you're forced to come here? You're here because you want to learn, right? And with your research, you want to actually get your work referenced. Correct? Every scientist whose phone is ringing. Okay, so you want your phone to... so you want your work to be recognized. And you know, I'm telling you a story some, say 40, 45 years ago, when I was young. My friend's father was a brilliant scientist. He used to work with an institution called Post Institute, which is a premium institution where only learned people go. And he was like very, very brilliant, and he was always doing his experiments and all of that. He had a brilliant son also. So my friend was also brilliant. This gentleman only knew how to work, and he had discovered the formula for birth control pills. But those days, there was nothing online. You had to do everything in writing. I'm talking about 40 years ago. So he had probably submitted his work, and he didn't take a patent for it. So what happened, because he didn't take a patent for it, some commercial company took a patent and research, and you discover that it is really, really good, and it should be out to the public, you have a lot of opportunity. You've got this online, you can submit your work online, you've got a lot of language editing help, you've got a lot of technology that helps you, word processing, you've got scholar-bound manuscripts, you've got a whole lot of technology that can assist you. So while all of that is easy, even then, we want articles that will make a significant contribution to our field. And the other thing that we look at is authenticity. So you have to be sure that to get your work published in a high quality journal is not an easy job, it is a lot of hard work. While you have a lot of opportunities, it is still a lot of hard work. Publishable articles need to be based on solid scholarship, sounding goals, methodology, well-written, clear and concise message. I've already said this, I'd just like to focus on point number three. When I say well-written, English is the only medium accepted. And when you write, you need to write in the past tense. Please do not write in the present perfect tense or the present continuous tense. Like, I am boiling the water and the water is evaporating. Please. I boiled the water and it evaporated. Past tense. And always write in the active voice. No past, no passive voice. Do you know the difference between active voice and passive voice? Active voice is the boy ran on the road. And passive voice would be on the road the boy ran. Most trained here stick to active voice and past tense. Two rules that you need to remember. What is the difference between a thesis and an article? First thing that I would say is that, you know, that your thesis is going to be read by your professors, your own people who know you. So, you know, if you've written, you've moved up, your professor will be biased. He'll say, okay, she knows the answer. She's a bright child, but probably she couldn't do this. She was probably disturbed. So he'll be kind enough to give you some more marks. Whereas, when you're writing an article, when you're submitting it to a journal, the peer reviewers don't know you. They don't care who you are. They will slash you down. And they'll just cancel your paper. Another thing that you need to remember is that a thesis is actually trying to check your level of knowledge. Whereas, what is an article doing? It is talking about your contribution to your field of study. A thesis can be lengthy, you can keep on writing as much as you want, the more you write, the more marks you get. In Calcutta University, I know they used to weigh in the papers and give us marks. So the heavier your paper, the more marks you want. So thesis can be as much as you want, whereas if it is an article, it has to be to the point, there will be word limits, you will need to only focus on the referencing you've done for that particular research. In a thesis, you can say, oh, I studied 200 books, I read 200 books. The professors will be amazed, oh, she's done so much of study. But in that particular article, you will only talk about the books or the journals you refer to, your current reference. Good so far? Can I move on? Now, before I move on to the slide, I'm going to show you my platform. You might want to make a note of this. It's academic.oup.com. This is the URL for our platform, academic.oup.com. Your university does not subscribe to it as of now, so you will not have access to the full content. But nevertheless, I will show you how you can browse, and then I think the library will consider taking a subscription if you're interested. So here we are. This is the platform of Oxford Journals. time I want to go back to the home page, I just click on this tool. If you wish to see all the journals from A to Z, just click on this and you get a list of all the journals. You can also browse by subject. These are the five different subject areas that we talk about. We have arts and humanities, law, medicine and health, science and mathematics, and social sciences. We have a tab for authors. For all of you who are interested in getting your work published, everything that I'm talking about today is there in this platform. So if you forget what I have taught you today, you can always go to this platform and listen to it. So help is always at hand. Well, let's first do a little. Let's do a quick search. You see, this is the home page of the journal. It gives you the impact factor and it also gives you the 5-year impact factor. And here it tells you that it is published in partnership with this society. So if you click on this, you will get to see the society. You will find out about the society, what they do, the information that you need. Every journal homepage will have the submit button. When you click on the submit button, there is something called author guidelines. I'm going to explain this to you in detail as we proceed. I'm just showing you that this tab is there. How do you know that a movie is good or bad? Rating, right? How do you know a restaurant is good or bad? Do you have Zomato here? Okay, you look at the rating. Whatever site you have, each country has its own food site. You go and look at the rating and the reviews, right? How will you know whether a journal is good or bad? You will look at the impact factor. The higher the impact factor, the better the journal. Now there's a little catch here. How is the impact factor calculated? Do you know what citation is? All of you know what citation is, right? So, the impact factor is calculated taking the number of citations. What is the formula? Suppose I want the impact factor of the European Heart Journal for 2019. I will take the data of 2017 and 18, 2 years data. Number of times the article was cited, divided by the number of citable articles published in 2017. That will give me the impact factor of the European Heart Journal of 2019. So now we know how to take out the impact factor. You don't need to take it out. That is done by council writers. You just need to take a look at it and decide. next question to you. Which subject do you do maximum research on? Which subject is the maximum research on? Yes, never mind if you're wrong. I don't know everything. Medicine. Life sciences, chemistry. What happens is, see, science is changing every day. In the year 1980s, malaria was, I think most of you were not born then, but malaria was eradicated. 1985, nobody got malaria. It was completely cured. But now, malaria is back in fashion. Every second person you hear, I'm down with malignant malaria. Which means those mosquitoes, which that medicine that would work to fight them off, does not work now. Which means you need a stronger dose. So science has changed. So there's more discovery happening around it. But why is it not working? When you were small, or at least when I was small, if I had fever, the doctor said, don't take a shower. What does the doctor tell you today? Go stand under a cold shower. Get your temperature down. Kidney. Earlier when people had a kidney problem, the doctor would say, drink lots of water. Flush your kidneys. What does the doctor say now? Drink only 500 ml of water. Don't make your kidneys work so hard. Don't trouble them. So science has changed. Every day doctors are discovering something. Therefore, the impact factor of a journal in medicine would definitely be higher. It would be a big number. There's a journal on cancer where the impact factor is as high as 56. Which means that a medicine journal has a higher impact factor. But a journal, like the previous one we saw on criminal studies, the journal, what was the impact factor? 2. Does that mean people are not finding out about criminals? They are. But the number of the audience is less. In management, the audience is less. But that doesn't mean people are not studying management. But if there are 100 people, 60 will do medicine, 10 will do social sciences, 10 will do management, 10 will do computer. Getting me? So that does not mean that that journal is bad because it's got an impact factor of 2. So what should you do? You need to check the evolution of the impact factor. So every time you go to the journal homepage, you just go and look at about. And then you will see the evolution of the impact factor. And what do you see? It has steadily increased. From 7, it has gone up to. That will tell you whether the journal has progressed gradually. Now I'll tell you another story. I run a journal. It's called ABC. It's a useless journal. No one reads it. I give it to her for free. I give it to him for free. I give it to the lady there. I give it to the gentleman there who's smiling at me. He also throws it. No one reads that journal because it's useless. It's got utter rubbish in it. You know, I have a friend, my friend here. She's a scientist. She's brilliant. Her work is recognized. Everybody likes what she writes on. I request her, will you please write an article for my journal? One article. She writes it. I publish it in my journal. What happens? All these people who said no to my journal are using that article and citing it. Correct? So what has happened when people are citing it? The impact factor has gone up. Does that mean my journal has become good?
But then
it It's still not good, it's still useless. It is only that one article that has made the impact factor rise. Only one article has made the impact factor go up. It is still a useless journal. Therefore, it is very important for you to check the evolution of the impact factor. Are we good so far? Have I made the concept of impact factor absolutely clear to you? Have you understood this? You see, you will need this during your research, and nobody will explain all these points to you. Other publishers will come, they'll show you the platform and walk off. I'm giving you a lot of basic detailed information. So now we're done with the impact factor, we move on to the next point of discussion. Now I said you can browse by subject, you can choose which subject and choose the journal. You can also do a quick search. Let's choose something that is very happening today, which is cybercrime. It is scary. Our data is all over the place. Everywhere, LinkedIn, wherever you go, everybody knows our email ID, everybody knows where we stay, where people have our bank account. You know, we are always scared because it's all leaked. There's no privacy left. So let's look at cybercrime. Shop in Amazon. When you shop for something, what do? You filter color, size. That's the same thing that you do. So here you are, you're looking at research articles, which brings it to 665. I still don't have so much time. So let's say I'm looking at this from, I'm interested in this journal. Digital Object Identifier. What is the importance of it? It is a static, permanent reference number. It will never change. And why do you need it? Because, like I said, everyday science is changing. Today, if you're sitting and discovering something, trying to discover a cure for cancer, and you want to look at something that was discovered in 1980s, 1990s. Do you have the time to read all the journals on cancer in 1985, 1990? If you have the DOI number, you'll be able to pull up the article immediately. So it is of great use to the students, to the lecturers, and to the librarians. The lecturer can tell you, go to this DOI, here's the DOI. While you're doing your research, you may look up this article. So you've got the article here. Now, you can download this as a PDF. Now, because we don't have access to this, we don't have a subscription, we will not be able to download anything. But nevertheless, I will go to European Art Journal, because that's where you HTML is. You see these hyperlinks? It's external reading that each one has. This does not work in a PDF. This only works in an HTML. External reading will not work. So we've got this diagram, downloaded it. When you've downloaded it, it tells you, it gives you the citation information. Correct? If from a PDF, if you use the snipping tool and you snip it and put it, there's no authenticity that you have taken it from such and such place. And you will also forget that when you have an HTML, you can download it and attach it to your research. Going back to the article. The third most important thing on this page that I want to show you is this. You see this donut? I love donuts. So what does a donut do? It is the altimetric score. What does the altimetric score do? It gives you the demographic readership analysis across the board. It tells you how many people have viewed it, how many PDF downloads, and all of that. And if you click on See More Details, it will give you a world map showing which part, which countries of the world this article people have been interested in. You see, there's no interest in this in the US. There's a lot of interest on the surrounding, not in Southeast Asia. Let's give you the names of the countries. So if you're doing malaria, and you see the readership of that journal is here, there are no mosquitoes here in Iceland. There are no mosquitoes in Canada. So you know your research, you have to check your altimetric score as well. Doesn't this look interesting? Now we shall go back to our presentation. So how will you turn your thesis into an article? First thing, you will do your own homework. Is my research worthy of getting printed? And Newton discovered that if you throw an apple up, it falls down. You discover if I throw the orange up, it comes down. Is that research? Is that research? That the orange comes down? The gentleman says yes. That has already been discovered. The law of gravity has already been discovered. You have to discover something new. So you have to check whether you've done enough research. The second thing that you have to do is, you can always write a letter of short communication. A rapid communication is what we call it. Now what is this? Let's say you are doing a research on how to track people stealing data from social network sites. You're trying to find a software that can detect it. You're doing a study on that. Now, somebody has already done that and published the article. The article is out while you're still working. So you read that article and you see that this person has written point 1, 2, 3. But you have discovered point 4 and 5 also. You've discovered 5 points, out of which 3 he has published. So you can write to him as a letter of short communication saying that I have read your research and I was also doing a similar research and I think it's really, really good. And I have found out that there are these two other factors as well. So you might want to include it in your article. So that gives gives you recognition for your work as well. Right? So, you can write a letter of short communication. And the third thing that you can do is, you can actually review papers. But in OUP, review papers come only by invitation. You will not be asked to review somebody's paper unless you are somewhere at the job. Step two, choose your journal. How will you choose your journal? You will check the altimetric score. You will check the impact factor. You will check the readership, right? You will check all of that, and then you will decide that, okay, I want to write to this journal. Now, a lot of people make this mistake that they write the article. Then they go around looking around. Who's going to take my paper? Achha, you take it. You don't want it. I'm going to take it. No. Choose your journal. Read the guidelines for authors. That tab I showed you, read that first. You know, one will say, I want Calibri 10, one will say, I want Tahoma 11, another one will say, I want Book Sans 14. Different people will ask for different font sizes, different formats. So choose, before you write your article, first choose the journal, and then start working. And tie a knot in your hanky, wherever, in your hair, wherever, but remember, you must not submit to 2-3 journals in one go. Submit to one journal at a time. If you gamble by sending the same article to 3-4 places, not only will your article get rejected, you might also be blacklisted. You might lose credibility in the research world. So don't gamble. And I told you about the guide for authors. These are the different kinds of research articles. One is the original research, I told you. Rapid communication, I have explained. Review articles, I have explained. The fourth one is case studies. Let me tell you a little story. I have a friend who was very, very ill. 3 months she was in and out of hospital. She went to the best doctors in town. She was admitted, and it was a bad UTI, which just no antibiotics worked. And every time they did a culture sensitivity test, they found out so much, and they tried experimenting with her. And she had given up one life. She said, look, I'm going to die like this. I'm going to be like one of those Rabindranath Tagore characters who's going to be terminally ill and die. So she'd given up. And then 3 months she didn't go to work. She was at home, in and out of hospitals and doctors, and then she gave up. She said, I'm not going for it. And somebody took her to a hole in the wall doctor. So a small doctor sitting who has a little chamber in the garage. And she went to the doctor and she said, look, I've come because they brought me here, but I'm not going to take your medicines. So angry. She told the doctor, I will not take your medicines. The doctor said, I won't give you any medicines. He gave her a probiotic and he gave her cranberry tablets. He said, you have these tablets twice a day. One probiotic and one cranberry tablet in the morning. One probiotic and one cranberry tablet. And all you need to do is just drink 4 liters. That's it. And come back. I'm not giving you any antibiotics. No painkillers, nothing. In 15 days, she joined work. That's a nice case study. Right? So you can also think of case studies in your research. How do you find the right journal? I have already explained this to you. Speed, when you read the author guidelines, it will tell you how long it takes for your journal to be processed, first peer review, second peer review. It tells you, so you can decide accordingly. And I've already told you, choose your journal before you start writing your article, otherwise you'll be in trouble. You'll do a lot of hard work. How do you write a manuscript, a good manuscript? In the airport, I saw this book. title should be interesting enough for someone to want to read your article. I recently posted something on LinkedIn, and the headline the title I had given was "Communication is not what is said, but how it is heard." I might be saying, hey, don't do this. I am saying it very affectionately. But you are hearing it as she was so rude. She told me don't do this. So how you're hearing is what communication is. So the title actually captures the attention. The abstract. The abstract means the summary. Can she write a book and you write the summary for her book? Is it possible? Possible. But will you be doing justice? Because your understanding of her book will be different than what she has wanted, the idea that she has wanted to give out. Therefore, it is important that you, the author, writes the summary. Make sure it's concise, it gives a brief idea of what methodology you've taken and the results that you have achieved. The title and abstract, as a rule, should always be written last. Nobody gives a movie a title first and then thinks about how to perform. Choose the right keywords. If you have the right keywords, they quickly come up in the discoverability. Method should be detailed and precise. I told you written in past tense. Results should have all the findings. And conclusion, you should be able to conclude with the idea or the thought that you're trying to convey to the audience. Okay? This is an example of how you can use post-it notes for your when you're writing your research. And an example of mind mapping. So now you've finished writing your paper. Chosen your journal, you've decided what you want to research. Now what is the next step? Submitting it. So we shall talk about how you can submit your paper after the break. What is the time now? My watch says 8:30. It gives me India time, which means 8:30, 9:30, 11. Right? 11:15, please be back. Take a 15-minute break and be back in. All fresh for the second session. Okay, so we'll have to stick to slides. I'm really sorry because the slide is down. This I have already explained. I'm not repeating them. Manuscripts should be written in English. I want to. Yes, you can use language services to get your work professionally edited, especially if English is not your first language. There are so many different language servicing sites. We are not endorsing or taking guarantee for any of these. The choice is yours, we're just giving you a suggestion. So don't come back and say, your trainer said from Oxford, Sumita Sen said this. It's clearly written, we do not endorse or guarantee. So when you're preparing your manuscript, when you're writing out your article, you will want to check the journal's website whether they accept the latte template. What is the latte? It's not latex as it's spelled, it's pronounced as latte. Latte is a word processing unit. It's a word processing software which makes scientific publishing is not in the
is rubber. Here, for software, it is latte. Okay, it's latte, L-A-T-E-H. Now, you, again, you can go to YouTube and check, look at the tutorial on this. What happens is, this is in the software, you just put in what are, what is the kind of format you want, what is the font you want, how do you want your diagrams to go. So it makes work much easier for you. So that you don't have to keep correcting the appearance of this. You can just keep typing your article and it will automatically take it in that format. Submission sites, this is what I was showing you. They ask you to create an online ORCID ID. I've explained what an ORCID ID is. So this is how you create an ID. This is the process in which you create your ID. And at the end of it, you tick, can you say, yes, I am ready and acknowledged. Privacy policies, and then click on finish. So we were here, we were talking about submitting a research paper. These are the steps that it takes. So you keep uploading how you want and it keeps giving you an error message when you've not done something. I've explained ORCID ID to you, so I don't want to be repetitive. There is a very interesting tab on reviewers. You remember I told you to check the editorial board. So somebody from the editorial board will be reviewing your paper. So if you have a particular respect for some of the professors on the board, you can always say, I refer this reviewer, I'd like this professor to review my paper. You also have the option of saying, I oppose this reviewer. Trust me, it remains confidential, that reviewer will not come to know that you have opposed him. And you don't need to give a reason. But if you think that that person does not like me and he might cancel my paper, you always have the right to do that. You can always oppose a reviewer. So what is peer review? Peer review is actually the academic term for quality control. Without peer review, there would be no control. Anyone would be cheating, looting, and everyone would be saying, this is my work, and there'd be battles every time and nothing would get published. So it is an academic term for quality control, and it tells you whether the research is valid, significant, and original. Generally, papers are reviewed by 2 to 3 reviewers. Sometimes there are 5 reviewers. And the reviewers never get to know who you are. That's another plus point. This is how the process works. You have an idea, you've written it out. The manuscript is the raw form. Once it is published, it becomes an article. So you have the manuscript written, you send it to the journal editor, you submit they are bound to give you reasons why. So, you know, you don't look at a rejection and sit and cry. I remember I was rejected by Trinity College. I'm glad they rejected me, though, because then I wouldn't have got Oxford University Press. But when I was rejected by Trinity, I cried and cried and cried. 3 days I cried. as if the world had come to an end. But I think God had better plans for me. But, and everyone said, write to Trinity and ask them why they rejected you. So I wrote to them, and I got a response. They said that you come from a very corporate background. We're looking for people who are used to teaching children. You have no experience with small children. And the role, the job role required. So they are bound to give you feedback. And my response to them was that in that case, why did you even let me go through all this training and all that? They made me do the training also, and then they rejected. But I'm happy they rejected. I wouldn't have been here to give them. But that's not the point. That was just deviating from the guideline. So you are allowed, you have the authority, the right to ask why your article has been rejected. So you can track the progress with that manuscript ID. After it is accepted, it comes to the OUP. This is when a unique DOI is created and sent to. Now you remember why I was explaining those factors? Do you see each one is getting linked to the session? I'm linking it to how to publish. Yes? So your article will be given a unique DOI number, which will always be a permanent number. Remember that after the journal has sent it to the production team to OUP, the journal will have no say in it. Then your communication is with OUP directly. So you communicate with OUP how you want to proceed and what is to be done. They will send you a link to our author services site. Yeah? And they'll ask you to create an account to sign a license to publish. You will be asked to sign a license that I'm allowing you to publish my work. It's been peer-reviewed, approved, fine, but you still have to sign that license. Now, licensing agreements, funding policies, all of that is a separate session. That is stage two. Right now, you're just learning how to get it. That is stage two. When you're finished and submitted, then call me again. Like I told you, remember the author services site is separate from the journal's manuscript site. After the accepted papers are there, they are copy edited to match the journal style and ensure the clarity. Remember, they will ask you to make any changes if you want. You know, you may get the raw format of it. And you have the right if you want to make any changes to a language or something. You then have the authority to write back and say, okay, I'd like these changes to be made. The editorial team will still consider. But once it is published, it is out to the public, then we do not make any changes. Unless there is a serious change in the academic authenticity of the article. Otherwise, we don't. So here you are, they will ask you. After that, you will be given a free link. There will be social metrics that you will have to sign up, whether you can share it on LinkedIn and when can you share it on LinkedIn, Twitter, Tumblr, wherever you want to share it. There are special policies you'll have to sign in that, you'll have to read them and sign the agreement and follow those rules, because if you break any guideline, you'll probably be blacklisted in the academic field. If the authors have embargoes on papers, you know what embargoes is? Embargo is, you know, the period when for some time your article is a paid article. As in, somebody has to take a subscription. You are not able to see all the articles on the OUP site. They're saying that purchase it, you only see the abstract. But after a point, after say 3 months or 6 months, the article becomes free for the audience. So that embargo note in the cover letter. Make sure your cover letter is written nicely, because that is the first communication that the production team gets. And they will form an opinion basis. You will never get a second chance to make a good first impression.
That's that. Corrections are only made in the first.
As I already told you.
This I already shared.
Yes, majority of our publishing is performed at no cost to the author. You submit your research, we don't charge the author. But sometimes the author says, I've discovered something really nice. I've discovered this marvelous cure to cancer. That the minute you take one pill, your cancer is cured. Just thinking. But so you want that research to be open to the public. Everyone should read it. So that is when, what do you have to do? The author has to pay OUP to get his work published in open access. Now, because the author is paying does not mean that you will write Jack and Jill went up the hill and OUP will publish it. It will still go through the rigorous series of peer review. It still follows the OUP policy. And whatever is published under the OUP umbrella, you can be sure that it is authentic, it has gone through the series of batting and peer review. We do not publish rubbish. We are not picky. It comes with that big Oxford stamp.
This I told you.
Everything is there in the author section. So check the author section, you'll be able to open the hyperlinks and read and do it yourself. So there's a lot of homework for you to do when you go back.
I explained open access, it's free and unrestricted online access.
Any questions? Long, but then that you have to keep dealing with the editorial. They'll tell you why it's being delayed and what stage it is. So you know you'll be able to see it on the site itself. They'll send you the ID. So you'll be able to track your progress. The author's tab, if you go, you get all the details. And it varies from that. There's no fixed hard and fast rule. I can't say 48 hours and yes, it will be. Any more questions? Many reasons. Plagiarism. Language. The idea is not clear. The idea is not authentic. Somebody has already found this research, done this research. It's already been published with some other journal. Many reasons. And because it's blind peer review, nobody knows who you are, so there's no enmity or animosity that someone's going to reject it. Any more questions? Yes. They'll tell you, they will tell you that we will take so much once it goes to the production team, we will receive communication. Then your dealing is with them. I am only certified to do this much. Any more questions? These are the different open access tools that we have. Such a wonderful audience. I'll just share my email ID with you if you have any questions. Please write to me.